Happy Monday, everyone, and welcome to a very special edition of Richard Skipper Celebrates. Why is today special? Because I get a chance to sit down and celebrate one of my best friends, one of my favorite people in the industry, and a great entertainer at that. You know, it's been a while trying to get her on here because she is probably one of the hardest working women I know. But today we're going to be celebrating Jennifer Roberts, Sheldon Harnick. She loves me, she loves Sheldon, and I love her. Here she is, Jennifer Roberts.
Hi, Richard. Hi,
Jennifer.
Hello, I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's so great to sit down and see. You know, we're so used to seeing each other in person.
I know.
That this seems a little odd, but I love you very much, and you know that. I'll just tell everybody the kind of person you are. A lot of people know that my mom recently passed away, and you came down to South Carolina to be with me and Danny and to meet my family, and it was something that I will cherish and hold dear to my heart for as long as I live. So thank you.
You're welcome. I told your brother, I think, and maybe Danny, that when my grandfather passed away, two of my parents' friends drove separately like 10 hours to be at my dad's funeral, his father's funeral, my granddad. And it always touched me and moved me. So when I knew that I was going to be, I don't know, 6 hours from where the funeral was, I made it a priority to be with you.
So that means a lot. So one of the things that I do on the show, those who watch the show regularly will know this. My show is all about celebrating life, celebrating art, celebrating artists. And I begin our interview with a mystery question. So there are two, A or B. So you pick.
A.
And your question of the day is, if I can even get it out of the box here, whatever room I walk into, I change the atmosphere in a positive way. Do you believe that about yourself?
I do if I remind myself of that. Absolutely. A lot of the times we're just rushing around and running and going from place to place. But the minute I breathe in and think about all that's great that's going on in my life, I do change the air of the room or the feeling of the room.
Jennifer, do you remember how you and I met?
We met on Facebook years ago. You became my Facebook friend before we met in person. Mm-hmm. And then I'm trying, oh yeah. So we had been Facebook friends for several years, and I was at the Mark Giannis, what's the name of the open mic that just ended?
Salon.
You came in. I think we had been emailing back and forth a while, but you came in, you were seated next to me. And I was kind of embarrassed or shy to say hello at that time. But then I wrote you and you were actually sitting right next to me. So I'm trying to remember the very first time we met. Was it when you came to our show?
No. Well, I saw your not your Sheldon show, but your previous show.
Right, and I think
was there for that.
You came to the 10:30 show, and before the show, you came and gave me a big hug. But I think that's the first time we physically met, wasn't it? Or had we met before that? Because you'd invited me.
You're just one of those people that I feel that you've been a part of my life for as long as I can remember. So I was trying to figure out, how did we actually meet? And I don't know. The bottom line is we met. I'm happy about that.
Yes, I think you had invited me to do your Richard Skipper Celebrate shows. I mean, the Lori Beachman shows. And I couldn't do it. We met, I think, maybe for lunch or dinner the first time.
Even before that, I was asked to fill in for someone who used to have a radio program in the city. I was actually in a real studio, and I reached out to you and said, how would you like to be my guest on the show? And yes, we had the best time that night. Do you remember that?
Well, I do remember that clearly. But you had already come to my first An Evening with Jennifer Roberts show, and I think at least one of the Sheldon shows. That was a thrill, and that was a really fun evening, yes. Then we had a lovely dinner. Yeah.
I want to go back. I asked my guest, and I don't know that I've ever asked you this question before, but I always ask my guests to go back to their five-year-old self. And the reason I do that is because to me, the five-year-old self is the purest self. It's before life begins to tell you who you are, who you should be, who you shouldn't be, and all that encompasses. So I want to ask you, about the five-year-old Jennifer Roberts, where you grew up, what your family life was like, your exposure to the arts, how that all began for you.
So when I was just turning five, or just before I turned five, we moved to Farmington Hills, Michigan, from, I think, Tennessee, Kingsport, Tennessee. My parents had moved around quite a bit till I was five, and then we stayed in Farmington Hills for years. And so we had just moved. I was a little shy because it was a new school. I loved the arts very early on. Well, my mom is a classically trained singer. She's a brilliant singer. And my dad dabbled in, he did a lot of four-part harmony singing, choir. That's where I got kind of my voice and musicality from both of them. So he would play like banjo around the house. We had bluegrass going, classical, musical theater, you name it. I grew up with all those albums, and they took us to theater a lot. So I was definitely immersed in it at five. But at seven, eight, nine, somewhere in there, my dad started a movie theater in our basement. I talk about this in my Sheldon show.
Yes.
So from the time I was seven, eight, nine, we were downstairs in the basement watching classic film every single night. We saw everything.
On a screen or a sheet?
It started as a sheet over a bookcase. Yes. Isn't that funny? But it's the truth. He built furniture for our home. So he had built this beautiful bookcase, and he started with just a sheet over, you know, this bookcase. We didn't care. And then it was such a success because nobody had film back then. There was no screens at home and all that. So he built a movie room in that house with us, with a glass room in the back separating the movie theater or the projector from the actual room where we all sat. And then we had a screen up that he actually built, and it had windows like just block mm-hmm. pieces of whatever they were, some kind of wood, where he would shut it for the regular screen, and he would open it to the full cinema scope. So we got the maximum framed film, regardless of what size it was. So that was very special. So we invited.
Now, was your family also a television household?
Yes. Oh, yes. We watched TV. Yeah, a lot.
As a family.
Yeah, especially. Yeah, we did it Friday nights. We had a steak meal or some kind of special meal in the basement, which my dad had created into this like living room space. And we'd watch, you know, whatever, Mr. Limpet, all the Don Knotts, you know, whatever classic films were coming on the TV, we watched those. But then we would have special showings in the back room, which started out as a playroom and became our movie room. So I invited everybody, college friends, high school friends, junior high friends, neighbors. Everybody remembers that room. But yeah, that's why I'm so immersed.
And brothers and sisters?
I have one younger brother, 5 years younger, Brian. And I have a sister that's just under 2 years, Julia. Julia Roberts.
Julia Roberts. I love this. Now, I mean, did anyone else in your family have the inclination to go, pursue this as a career? And was it because your parents got married, that they settled down, that your mom gave up her singing, or did she continue to sing?
She continued to sing the whole time I was growing up. She sang with magical choirs. She was a church soloist. She took voice lessons from the famous AV crew in Detroit, who everybody studied with. And his daughter was the musical director at our church, or the choir director at our church. So that was very cool to have really good music when we were young in church. But she kept singing. She did some musical theater later on. She did operas also. And a really little tiny lady with a huge voice. And then my dad, he continued in the church choirs up until recently. COVID kind of stopped him from getting together. All these years he's been singing. And then I don't think she left singing because of that. That was her major, but she wanted to do other things. But they definitely incorporated it into our lives the whole time. And they were very supportive when I would do musical theater. But I'm the only one from, I would say, if not by five, by seven, that I knew that's what I wanted to do. Very, very young.
Now, was there a pivotal moment for you where you first discovered that you had this gift, your voice? And when did you start exposing that voice to other people? A lot of kids, I was one of them. It started with the hairbrush in front of the mirror, singing in our house, imagining that I was in a recording studio. That was my big thing. But what was that moment like for you?
I will tell you, I don't think I've ever shared this, but yes, at five, six, seven, eight, I've got the hairbrush. I'm in our huge movie room singing. I now that I think about it, I really digested a lot of musical theater, like all the albums. We had Jesus Christ Superstar. We had My Fair Lady. We had Carol and Julie Andrews at and I learned comedy from those albums. I listened to everything. I listened to vocal jazz, everything I listened to. So I was always pretending in our basement, always. And then I would sing down the street, and because we watched Sing in the Rain, I would sing and do the numbers in the rain outside with friends. But I was very shy. So I knew my parents had voices. I sang with all the growing up church choir, the cherubs choir, and then also the school choirs. And it was about third grade. I don't know if I would have been 8, 9. I don't know what third grade is now, but there was a solo coming up in our grade school, or maybe junior high. And I said, I think I'm going to do this. Yeah, I was still in grade school. I said, I think I'm going to audition for this little solo. And I actually got it. And I was really surprised because I was very shy. So I got it. And around the same time, I got a couple of solos at the church. So I was already at whatever age that was, 8, 9, I was doing a lot of solo work. And that's how that began. And then I did a lot of music in junior high school, college. The segue between high school and college, I started doing summer theater in the summers. And then very young, 21, I was hired at Opryland to do the song and dance there for years. And so—
Well, you're jumping ahead of my story for just a moment. Because I want to ask you, there are two moments in most entertainers' life. There's that moment where you say, I'm going to pursue this. And then the next moment is when you seriously begin to pursue it. So what was the moment, first of all, when you said, this is what I'm going to pursue?
I knew for sure by 18. I knew I really wanted to do it younger. And I did. My parents, one of the best things that they did, I never had dance lessons till college age, but they put me in private voice lessons at 15.
Wow.
And that's one of the reasons that I have real good control over my instrument, because I learned to breathe at 15, 16, 17. I did all the state competitions. I did tons and tons of solo work in the high school realm, you know, with a choir, without. I did the pop shows. So all then, I think by 17, 18, I knew for sure that's what I wanted to do. So my parents kept saying, you need to get a real, you know, a real job. You need to do something. So I started as a music major, thinking I can always do teaching down the road, vocal performance. And then I knew by that fall, when I was 18 or 19, that I was going to for sure pursue it. So I moved from a small college in Grand Rapids, Calvin College, that did not have a musical theater program, to Wayne State in Detroit. And that was when I knew I'm going to do this full time. I got a great, great base for everything I do now. We had a brilliant, I talk about it all the time, dance teacher, Naira Pullen, who I still see on and off, who took me and Bob Lambert, you know, Bob Lambert.
Who was Broadway.
She took us from semi non-dancers to dancing for a living. So that's what she did for many of us. And then because there was not a soprano like me at Wayne at the time, I started getting all the leads in a lot of shows. I just started getting this amazing experience in a Broadway sized stage at this theater. So I did like 5 shows as a sophomore, the lead in Pippin and a show called Detective Story. And I was one of 6 in Starting Here, Starting Now. So by the time I did that, I had just done summer theater before and thought, I kind of want to do this, to making that choice to go there. I was 100% in for a very long time. And I never moved to New York. It could still happen. But I just made my living at it. I loved doing it. I loved the challenge of learning, you know, material, working with actors on stage. I really do miss that, because, you know, a lot of what we do now is monologues or, you know, even when you're doing a show, a cabaret show, even though you've got an audience you're playing to, it's not the same as having somebody right there with you.
Well, I'm going to say to every casting director who's happens to see this show, if you do see, go back to live auditions. Yes. Because there's nothing like that moment between the artist and the casting director or the people on the other side. We need that energy. As artists, number one,
that's
number one. And number two, you're not in a situation where you can say, let's try this a different way. So this idea of self-tapes needs to go. It needs to disappear. I don't like it. But you said something earlier. You know, there comes a moment for me, I grew up in South Carolina, and you saw my hometown, but there comes a moment where you go, New York, LA, and you didn't make that choice. You went to Nashville. Mm-hmm. Now, going to Nashville, did you go to Nashville to pursue work, or did you go to Nashville because you had work?
I had work. So everybody, all my instructors, everybody that had seen me on stage said, you need to be in New York. You need to be in New York. My parents had taken us to see these shows at Opryland when I was singing all that time, 15, but I think I was like 17. And I knew I wanted to do that. It was high, high level song and dance, choral, vocal solo, amazing, amazing production. So I wanted to go there. And I was actually hired there at 21. So if I was to, and I did several summers there, 21, 22. When I was 23, I came back to Detroit for a year, got my equity card, actually, and then moving back to Nashville.
What was the show that you got your equity card with?
It's called The Children's Hour, and it's a Lillian Hellman.
Yes.
And with a lot of the stuff that I did, I walked in the door. Somebody needed me. He loved my read. I'm cast. I had to get my equity card, which was great. I worked with Jane Houdyshell and wow. a bunch of great actors, and the director, who's still living, Terrence Kilburn. He used to run Meadowbrook Theater.
Now, interestingly enough, you get your equity card on a non-musical show.
Yeah, I did a lot of straight plays in my beginning, and I still love working as an actor more than I love working as a singer. Like, I love vocal harmony. I love working with other singers and musicians, but I really have always loved creating roles, and I've always loved the acting part. So yeah, I got this pretty big role in that show. And then one of the second or third shows that I did at Wayne State was a straight play, and I was the lead, and I was sophomore. I was really good cold reader. I was really confident. I was shy, but I was still, you know, I was confident going in. And so
were these shows at Wayne State Equity Productions?
No, that was college, but Children's Hour was professional theater in Detroit, Meadowbrook Theater. And Terrence, who I was going to say, Kilburn, was the original Tiny Tim in the original production of Christmas Carol. And he was in Detroit running this theater for years, the kindest man. But when he called me in to do more stuff, my heart wasn't in that audition. And I blew that audition. And I thought, well, you know, maybe I'll audition for him again. And then Nashville opened again, and I moved there. But he called me 8 months later, and my dad did not tell me for many years that he had called me because he wanted me to be in, not Sondheim on Sondheim, but the other one. What's the older Sondheim medley?
Side by Side.
Side by Side. He wanted me to be in that. And I had just moved back to Nashville, so I missed that opportunity. But I did not move on to New York. I needed to do it right away, especially when my chops were really, you know, at a really good place, and my dance was very easy. I stayed in Nashville because the doors kept opening. I was doing Broadway quality shows, and then I ended up getting married, which I don't talk about often. And then when that ended, I came back to Detroit thinking I'm going to regroup. And again, that would have been a great time when a lot of my friends were going to New York. So within a year or two in Detroit, I'm working all the time in TV and commercials. And I started working with the Symphony and the All Night Strut in downtown Detroit. I mean, things just kept happening for me, and I did not make the move. I just kept working.
Well, so let me ask you, you don't have to go here if you don't want to, because I know those years that you were married, I know nothing about. But during that time frame, did you continue to pursue your career? Did you stop? And was your spouse supportive of what you wanted to do?
Well, I don't know. So he was a performer when I met him. And I had the dream of working with my husband. So I envisioned us singing and doing things. So we sang some weddings together, and people thought we were amazing, including a really famous producer in Nashville, Jerry Crutchfield, who just passed away. He told my dad that my level of vocal ability was, you know, I don't know how to say it, but he was very impressed. And he kept telling my dad that. But no, my ex had some issues. So when I married him, he did not want me to perform. So occasionally, to make extra money, I would say, I've been invited to do this tour. Can I do the tour? We'll be making extra money. So he let me go. And then, you know, Nashville a long time ago. And then I didn't do shows at the park for a while because he didn't want me to. And then I had the chance to do another thing where I performed. And so he said, yes, as long as there was a benefit to the household, then I was able to perform. But no, it was 2 years where I was a motivational educational trainer at Opryland. I taught all the new frontline people how to interact with the public, how to smile, how to greet people. I taught supervisory classes and management classes on what you talk about all the time, positive attitude, you know, everything about going in on your A game. I loved that work, but I would really miss performing. And then I had the opportunity to do a big Reno industrial. It was in Reno, Nevada for Opryland. So I did that. And, you know, I put all that aside. We thought we might do some recording together, but nothing really moved forward with that. And then I think right after we separated, I was directing my first play at a school called Brentwood Academy in Nashville. It's a real prestigious school where a lot of the stars kids went. And I directed and they loved me. They actually voted me teacher of the year. I loved this. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, fluke, I get into the General Jackson show on the Showboat in Nashville, which was one of my very favorite jobs. So I did that for 3 months. And then after that contract ended, I moved back to Detroit. So that's kind of, again, another opportunity if I wouldn't have been in that situation where I would have moved forward to New York or LA, but at the time, New York. But no, I went back to Michigan and took a little bit of time to heal, but doors kept opening for me to perform, and that's what I was doing.
Well, when you're talented like you are, excuse me, it's going to find you. What do you think is the greatest training that you got from, or the greatest life lessons that you got from the years and the work that you did in Nashville?
I always went as a cast member humbly. Like, I was always blown away by other people's talent, and I didn't realize that I had a lot of talent. I just always looked up to everybody else. But I was one of the performers that kept getting hired back to do new things. And I was one of the first people that they continually put on that cable network shows that you've seen. First, it was called Opryland on Stage. So I had a work ethic, really strong work ethic. I was very professional. I'd go in, and for all those tapings I did, like 15 to 17 of them, it was one run through of the song and it was film. And there were no mistakes, which to me is mind blowing now. But I, you know, I just, whatever I was called to do, I did. And so they used me a lot as an ensemble person where they could throw me into some show and teach me all the choreography and whatever vocal part that I was supposed to learn. And I'd learn it on my own or learn it them. And then I would continually keep my work at a high level. So that's something that I learned there. Mm-hmm. I was already singing vocal jazz and classical and working with ensembles and choirs and learning choreography in high school and a little bit in junior high. So all of that I took to Nashville, where a lot of the people that worked there were just starting out and really didn't have that experience. So I came in with a lot more experience and a lot of stage work. And then that carried me through. So when I moved back to Detroit and I auditioned for this show, the All Night Strut, I ended up first understudying the soprano, which is a white role. And then I stayed with that show for 2 years. That's how I was able to buy my house. And I went on a lot for her, and she got married, and I was able to go on that weekend. But it was the same thing. It's singing four-part harmony. It was extremely difficult choreography. I brought that same level of being able to learn the material and delivering night after night. So the director had created a second show. It was supposed to be a sequel. So she asked me if I would audition for it. And when I came in and I sang Heat Wave and another belting song, she had the idea to use me not only as the soprano understudy, but now the black understudy or the alto role. So they called me and said, can you please do both? And I'm like, oh, no, no, no way. You couldn't pay me enough. I know how much work one role is, let alone two. And so they kind of bribed me and I needed it. So I said, okay, I'll do it. So I learned that entire alto role, all of the intricate four-part harmony, solos on different notes and different beats. I learned all of that on my own time before the first rehearsal. I know. And I just talked to the director, Fran, and said, that's what they expect in New York. So I already have that experience. I learned how to do that in Nashville. I brought it to Detroit for this show. And then I frequently went on for both. So nobody until I just was given the Christmas show footage that I put out on YouTube at Christmas because I was so excited. The director handed it over to me and said, you can share it. But I was on for the black role, the alto role, but I also regularly worked for the other ones. So unless you really see how intricate and difficult that was, like our solos would be like a beat off depending on which role I was, the choreography would be reversed, but also the timing would sometimes be different. The solos were different. So all of that I brought from my Nashville experience to be able to do that. And then
what kind of preparation does one have to be able to switch gears sometimes on a moment's notice to be able to go on and do something like that?
Well, I will tell you, I have a really good ear that I had to get from both my mom and dad, but I think my dad. So I knew the soprano role. So when I was learning the alto role, I had to put the soprano role out of mind, and I learned the alto entirety. But as fate would have it, as usually happens in the theater, the lady I was understudying, Rachel, injured her knee or something right before opening night. Or maybe she was vocally sick, I can't remember. But I got a call on Thanksgiving the night before the show was opening saying, we need you to go on for the alto. And I didn't even fully know that role yet. So they had me do the first half of the show, and then she went on a few times in the second half, and then I ended up learning the whole thing. But it's a different skill set. So I was blessed with the exception of two times where I knew a week in advance or a few days in advance that I was going to go on for one or the other. And there was times where I think Rachel was out for 3 weeks. So I got to really get into that role for 3 weeks, which I loved, rather than one night here, one night there. Mm-hmm. There was two or three times where I was going in. One time I went in for Lori across the state. I get home because I lived in West Michigan. And I get a call, you're not going to believe this, but you have to go on for Rachel tomorrow. And I'm like, that was the other role. So I had to switch gears and I didn't have enough time. So it was the only time where I would say I wasn't 100% professional. I showed up. I did the best I could. The guys had to move me around because it was mentally, it's too exhausting to do it. And after that was the only time. And I didn't fake. I mean, I knew every single note and every single four-part thing. So it wasn't like I was faking and, you know, singing other notes I knew it so well that I could go on fully and be the full alto role or the full soprano role. But normally I had just enough notice. It happened one other time too, where they had me go in for one. And then when I got there, they go, you're going to go on for Rachel, that it went better because I already knew the role a little bit better, but yeah.
Well, you must've felt like you were shot out of a cannon.
I did. Wow. The very first time I went on for Lori, which would have been around 1991 or two, they were allowing me to do auto shows. So I was traveling the country with auto shows, but the producer would call and say, you owe me a favor. You better get back. I think Lori's losing her voice. Better get back.
Oh my God.
So I had not fully been put in the show. This is the very first time I did it. And Lance Roberts, my director for the Sheldon show, was in the cast at the time. So I tell the Chicago people, I got to get to Detroit. I'm going on tomorrow. So I leave that job. I drive to Detroit. They throw me in this thing. I'm 99% there vocally. And then I went on and they were so supportive and it went amazingly well. But you really have to trust in those situations that you know the material. And I have to tell myself that for the shows that I'm doing now. I knew it. And they were very, very impressed on how well it went. And, you know, I guess I was learning the show all along, but that was a surprise. The first time I had to go on. And it was, like I said, less than 12 hours notice. And then for the other role, Rachel, I had Thanksgiving Day to prep before I had to go on the first time. That's not a lot of time, even though I was living and breathing the choral parts on my own time for several months or several weeks. It's still a different thing, as you know, when you get thrown on, because you have to know the comedy, the music, the choreography, where you come and go. That show is so high paced without a break. There is no intermission, and there's like two costume changes with no time. You know, that's your only time to get in and out. I think there was an intermission, but there was not like you get to sit around and not do anything. You were never off stage. We all four were always on stage, but there was an intermission. We changed into part two. I'm hoping to get video footage of the original show too, and that second half, which was so much fun. But yeah, that's.
Oh, now, you never moved to New York, but you have a presence in New York in the cabaret world. How did that happen for you? How did you begin to get a name for yourself in the cabaret world here in New York?
Well, something told me in my spirit, maybe, I don't know, early 90s, mid 90s, maybe almost 2000, that I needed to do a demo. So a gentleman stepped forward and produced my first demo, which is about 9 minutes long. And I shared it with different people, including some friends in New York. And this girl, Tina Marie Miller, who I hope comes to one of our Sheldon shows because she's come to all my other shows, she heard it and she burst out in tears. And she said, I am blown away and I feel like I need to connect you with New York. So she introduced me to a man who recently passed away, Jack Dabdu, who had been on Broadway for years in a bunch of great shows, and Mark Janis. And then Mark Janis connected me with Andy Gale. So that was my initial, I have on my heart that I want to do a cabaret show. So that was how that started. And Jack and I met a couple of times and he encouraged me with, because he was a teacher and a director, and he encouraged me to do some certain things. And then Mark and Andy and I, over a few months, put together my first show. And we did it three times. We did the first night at Judy's Chelsea, and then that room abruptly closed. We had another few bookings there, and that closed. So we moved it.
Because you're not a New Yorker and you're just getting started, how did you find your audience for that first show at Judy's? Or how did they find you?
Mostly family and friends. I don't think I knew, I didn't know anything about how we do our invitations and how we mass. There was no Facebook and mass media back then. There was like, you had to do it yourself. So I hired David Gillum. Yeah, there was good things about it. Remember David Gillum though?
David Gillum, of course, is Mark Janis's partner.
Yeah. And so he did some heavy hitting hard calls for me. And he got a lot of press involved. I mean, only one press came and he didn't review me, I think, which is a blessing. But he got some agents interested. He got a lot of people, a little bit of a buzz going on way back then. And then we did the show, I think it was December. So I had friends in town. I had my parents and my sister flew in, I think. I had some New York friends, two friends from Detroit, Lisa Polito and Alicia Hutchinson, close friends of mine from Auto Show Days. They flew in to support the show. So it was just mostly friends that first one. But then fast forward, Mark reached out to Sydney Meyer, our dear friend, to see if we could maybe move our show to Don't Tell Mama because Judy's abruptly closed. So Sydney said, yes, bring it.
The old Judy's, the one that was next to the Algonquin?
Well, this was in Chelsea, I think, wasn't it? Judy's Chelsea.
Judy's Chelsea, and then it became Helen's.
Okay, yeah.
But so you're right. They did shut down completely.
Yeah, and I got it. You know, he let me know through Mark because we had a really good couple of dates scheduled on Friday nights to do it moving forward. So Sydney said, yes, you can bring it here. So I moved the show there. And then by then, I always chose to do my first shows in New York where all my friends were in town doing auto shows. And then I have a lot of friends that live in New York. So I would word of mouth, get the word out. And we had some packed houses. And then, Broadway World, a lot of different publications will put the announcements of your shows out. And then segue that second time, I let a nice gap of time go through just traveling and doing all my other work. So when I started working with Ted Firth in it would have been, I think, 2014, he and Andy Gale and I put together that show that the CD is based on. By then I had more of a presence. And so we would continue to reach out Broadway World and what was Cabaret Hotspot came a little bit later, but what was Stu Hamstra's?
He did some Cabaret Hotline.
Cabaret Hotline. He did some press for me. You ended up doing some for me as well. But it was just kind of being there. But even when I was nominated for the 2019 Mac Award, people did not know who I was yet in the community. So that helped because, you know, Eugene interviewed me and my CD was nominated for Best CD. And I kind of pleaded for people to actually listen to it. Remember? So yes. They would really know, you know, what the CDs were. And then that got me some more press, some more interest. And then as time went on, you know, Marilyn Lester has done some things on me, you know, Cabaret Hotspot did some things on me. And the more that you do it, you know, people know your name, but they also know you. And then with Bob Levy's last two CDs, I had songs on the CDs that were nominated. And so that also got my name back out there, you know, so it's just, you know how it is. And then I've been going to events when I'm there. I was able to go to the Mac Awards that year, but you know, 20.
Which is tonight. So
I know.
Positive thoughts to everybody.
Yeah.
As I say to everyone who's nominated, whether you're nominated or not, enjoy the journey because the destination is not always as exciting as the journey. So enjoy every moment of it.
And it was a fabulous journey. It was so neat and exciting to be there and experience the whole evening. That was really special. But you know, 2020, I was getting ready after we did my Sheldon Harnick show 4 or 5 times in 2019. I was seriously considering making a move to New York. And then I was really working hard on the road, January, February, March. And then, when I was in Chicago and I was in Kansas City working, all of a sudden, places are shutting down and the virus is in the area and people.
March 12th.
Yeah. And I was on the road just before that. And it's the only time I've ever really driven to gigs. I drove to Chicago and Kansas City to avoid flying, but I was in Vegas in January. So all the places that I was, the virus was already there. I was just missing it. But you know, that stopped my momentum. It stopped my funds. I work so much more where I had really good income, where I could produce a show or I could, you know, go in the studio and record what I wanted. So that kind of stopped everything for quite a while. And that's when I started doing the songs for Bob Levy that at least got myself in the recording studio and got my name out there. So inch by inch, I'm doing things as I can get back into it. But, you know, that hurt a lot of people in our business.
Well, we've got to talk about your upcoming show because you are going to be at Green Room 42 on April 30th. And at 7 o'clock, I'm going to be there. And this is, of course, your tribute to Sheldon Harnick. I was there the night that Sheldon Harnick came to see the show. I love this photograph of you and Ted Firth with him.
I know.
And I love this photo.
You do that one.
Yes. But I want to ask you, what was the seed for this show? Whose idea was it to do Sheldon Harnick? And what is it about his music that resonates so deeply for you?
It was my idea. So when I first did my first cabaret show, I'm going to say 2001 or two, I took 2 Sheldon Harnick songs to the table. Someone's Been Sending Me Flowers and The Ballad of the Shape of Things. And Andy and Mark kind of said, a lot of, you know, more people do Someone's Been Sending Me Flowers, you should do Ballad of the Shape of Things. So I did. It got huge laughs. And then it ended up to be the beginning of my thinking about maybe doing a show. So for many years, as you know, I traveled for a living and I'd hit all the bookstores and music stores around the country. And I was collecting novelty songs off Blossom Dearie albums and off cast albums. And, you know, I was blessed to have some of my work put me in cars for a long period of time from place to place. So I would listen and absorb. And in the summers, I'd listen for hours at my house. And when a song would hit me, I'd make a mental note. So somewhere in there, I realized that all these ballads that I wanted to do, I did Amaya Balish at Wayne State as a 19-year-old. And that's my first connection with his lyrics. And I was blown away with how deep and insightful his character descriptions were. I still am blown away by that. I knew that at 19, how he spells out in the lyrics, nowhere else, the depth of the feeling and interest of the characters. And I knew that at 19, but I had all these ballads of his I wanted to do. And then I was collecting novelty songs. And then somewhere mid-90s, late 90s, I went to see Barbara Cook at the Carlisle. And I did not know what she was doing. I just went because it was Barbara Cook. And I'll never forget this. Somebody told me, you got to tip the maitre d' $20 and he'll give you a good seat. So I did. And he held me back from Michigan, hanging out at the bar in the Cafe Carlisle with this reviewer and his uncle. And I still don't know who they were. And he seated us together, these three, this maitre d'. So we three sat together all night. And the reviewer critic sat next to me and he would whisper things like, this is from Fiorello. You need to get the score. And then we talked that I had done Amalia and sang Ice Cream and all stuff. And then when a couple of songs came on, What Makes Me Love Him for one of them, he leaned over and he said, this is from the Apple Tree. It's a beautiful show. You got to buy the CD the CD. And this went on all night. So
I don't remember who this was.
No, I never got his name.
Wow, that's amazing.
And, you know, handsome. I don't know, 35, 40 at the time. I don't know. But I was like, I got all this great material. So mental note, the very next man she sings, I'm like, I want to sing that someday. Again, it's been many, many years since I heard that. Mm-hmm. What Makes Me Love Him. There was so many songs. Some I'd already known about and done, and some I was making mental note. So something hit me around 2016, 2015, right before we started going into the studio to record my first CD. I'm going to bring it up to Ted. We should do a Sheldon Harnick show while he's still living. Because I realized one day all these songs are written by the same guy and nobody knows this. So we Ted said, I loved Sheldon. I've met him a few times. Let's do it. So we met and we went through Will He Like Me and a few songs, and we were both super excited. So I had what I thought was a full selection of songs. But then I bought his Hidden Treasures album and An Evening with Sheldon Harnick, and I find another treasure trove of another 50 songs I want to sing. So I'm thinking, after revisiting some of these songs in the last few days, I want to do a sequel, a part two, because there was another 15, 20 that I wanted to do that I couldn't fit in this hour slot. And we started working things up, like If I Were a Rich Man, Lance wanted me to do it, but I had to fine tune, answer to your question, why does this resonate with me? I had to pick the songs that really spoke to me. And that's how I really narrowed it down. So there might be criticism. We're not doing, you know, more from Fiddler or more from the Rothschilds or whatever. But I picked lyrics that I connected to, songs that I thought the world needed to hear. And that's how this selection of songs came to be. But
don't you find a lot of times when people are doing Sheldon Harnick shows that they have to do these songs? I mean, even with my tribute to Hello Dolly, there are certain songs in the score that I don't do. And people say, well, why don't you do that? And I'll go, that will come in part two. Come back.
I think so. Yeah. Because Boston Beguine, Ted wanted me to do. It's hilarious. Alice Ghostly made it famous in 1952 or 55. It's hilarious. Ted wanted me to do it. I didn't have enough room. And then Lance wanted me to do Rich Man. We would love to have done Far From the Home I Love. We started up an arrangement on that. Mm. Dear Friend, it's one I really want to sing, but I'm already doing. It's from She Loves Me. It's mm-hmm. I've had three people go, I'm so looking forward to hearing that song. And I'm like, it's not in the show. Why? I already have four or five songs from She Loves Me. I sing two of the men's songs, open the show with one of them. And then I sing He Loves Me. And then I sing two of her ballads, and there might be a fifth. So there wasn't room to add another ballad, especially from that show, even though I love that song and that duet that the two women sing. There's just not enough time, you know. So that's how this show and these particular songs came together.
Now, you had done the show a few times before Sheldon Harnick came to see the show.
Yes. And I never thought he'd come. I mean, when I can honestly tell you, when I thought about doing the show, I never thought I would meet him, and I never thought he would come to see it.
I don't know if you remember the conversations you and I had about this time. You know, how do we get in there? How do we get in there? And but you stuck to it. Mm-hmm. And what was the catalyst that opened that door for him to be there?
Well, you know, I sent him a letter, which we talk about in the show, and he returned it. And then I wrote him, I think it said, I'm going to do your show based on your material. Because when I wrote him, this show wasn't even in baby stages yet. And so opening night, the first time we did it, which would have been 2016, I posted, we're celebrating you and all your brilliant work tonight. I put it on his Facebook page. And he wrote back, Dear Jennifer, I hope that your wonderful program is well received. Something like, I'm vacationing with my daughter and family in Hawaii, but I hope it's well received, so you'll do it again. So that was the beginning of him saying he wanted to come. I never expected a response. So we would invite him, and I heard the rumor through the rumor mill. In fact, Michael Colby told me that he gave him his postcard, one of my postcards, and showed it to Sheldon at a show and said, I'm going to go to your show. And Sheldon said, I'm going too. So we thought he might show up in 2018 at Pangea, but he didn't. And we never knew for sure. So KT Sullivan had invited him, and Ralph Lampkin had invited him for me, and I had invited him. And the rumor was he was coming. And then the rumor was he was going to come to the second show at the Beachman, which I think would have been 2019, February 5th or something like that. Instead, Karen Ziemba and Beth Ertz were coming that January 30th, the first of the two nights. And 30 minutes before the show, Karen and Beth came back to me and said, Sheldon's in the audience.
What was that moment like for you?
Excited, disbelief, shock. I didn't have any warning. I was looking forward to seeing him in a week, you know. It made me super nervous. I was super thrilled. And they said, we thought you'd probably want to know before the show instead of after. So it was mixed emailing. It made me more nervous. Thankfully, the review is as positive as it
is. And I was there that night.
There you were. And Jay Maynard was there. She got a great picture of me and Sheldon talking after the show. Marianne LaPinto is the one that took the photo. Eugene was there. I mean, a lot of friends. Russ Woolley was there with you guys. Karen Ziemba and Beth Ertz, I think, got him there. So the funny thing is, after the show, we talked. He told me he thought it was wonderful, which I thought meant so much. We talked about some of the songs and how did you get these songs? And Beth said, don't remember, you know, I asked for her for you and you sent them to her. So he knew, but you know, he was like 96 at that time. Mm-hmm. So we talked about it and he said, nobody does these songs anymore. So it thrilled my heart that he was thrilled to have them playing. And his wife gave me a couple corrections, things that she wanted me to maybe not sing because the lyrics have been changed. And I made artistic choice to leave the original lyrics in there. We talked about that. But then the funniest thing is at the end, it was a blizzard. So I think he canceled his other event that he was going to go to and he made it a priority to get to our show. So Mr. Harnick comes in a blizzard. A lot of my friends that live in New York canceled, didn't come. Mr. Harnick's there.
At 96.
And he said, it's really bad out there. And I said, yes, I can't believe you came, you know. So he understands when weather can, you know, can hurt an audience. So later on, I read this thing that he's really a funny man. And he made this comment about Just My Luck. What's the name of that show? The bodybuilder show. I forget the name of the show. It's the one that they wrote right before. I only had a 3-week run. Why am I forgetting it? Anyway, they did this, the first show that they did together. Let me see if I can find it on the postcard. The Body Beautiful. It only ran for 3 weeks. And he said, quip somewhere, it would have ran a fourth, but there was a blizzard. So isn't that hilarious?
That's what happened to Carol Channing's last revival of Hello Dolly.
So he knows.
Shut down because of a blizzard in New York.
Yeah, and that's what he said. And he did it as a, you know, comic quip, but I knew that he understood, you know, you can't make people come up with others bad. I had numerous friends that were coming in that didn't try, but he was there and they were most gracious and supportive. And he told me I'm going to come again. I saw him at Carnegie Hall like 3 weeks later and he remembered me, called me by name backstage. And I gave him my newest postcard for the fall. And he said, we're going to try to get there. But they didn't make it. And then COVID hit. So,
right.
It was,
you know, a couple of things. Number one, and I'll just put this as an aside, when Danny and I got married, you already know this, our officiant was a former publicist, and he reached out to Sheldon Harnick to write special lyrics, him and Jerry Bach. They came up with new lyrics for Sunrise Sunset, which was sung at our wedding before it was sung anywhere else at a same-sex marriage. And I wrote to him and he sent me the nicest note and he was just such a generous soul. And the other thing that I remember that I really loved that night was watching his reactions to your songs.
Because see, I couldn't see him.
Right, but I was sitting right across from him and Karen Ciampa was on the other side of him. And the fact that he was just so, effusive in his response to each of your songs. So, and of course, you know, with my Jerry Herman never saw me perform, except he was there the first night that I performed for Carol, and he was just incredibly generous. To have these moments, no matter what happens in your life or career, you do a tribute to Sheldon Harnick, and he's right there in the audience. And there aren't that many people who can actually say that.
No, and I chose songs that were special to him too. So he was thrilled that I was doing the obscure ones from the Hidden Treasures album, three or four in particular. And I read that he's very moved when someone sings It's My Own Lifetime. And I got to do that one for him. And that one I was really, really passionate about because I knew it was special to him. One Family, people don't know that. So I put that in there and I could see, and Will He Like Me, he loves, and I did some of the comedy numbers. But yeah, his sincere note to me was he was so thrilled that I was, it's a wonderful feeling when someone responds to my work as you did. So I send you my most profound thanks, Sheldon Harnick. And that was before we even conceived the show. So
how long the journey has it actually been from the moment that you came up with the idea that you were going to do this to this moment where, you know, in week after next, you will be doing this again in New York? How long a journey has this been?
I think it's been a 9-year journey, 9 to 10 year journey. Because I started, I wrote him in 2014 or the beginning of 15. I did not have the idea to do a Sheldon show till the fall of 2015 or the beginning of 2016. I think it was the fall of 2015 because we coordinated rehearsals, Ted and I, and Lance for this show with my recording An Evening with Jennifer Roberts in the studio in New York. So not living there, I'd go in for a few days. Ted and I would meet a couple times to, you know, work out numbers. And then I would be in the studio as well. So that would have been the beginning of 2015 or the beginning of 2016, all the way up through.
I want to talk about your collaborative process. And I'll start with Lance Roberts, your director. What exactly does Lance bring to the table for you? And you've kept him all this time through this entire journey. So obviously there's a symbiotic relationship there, but what is it that he brings to the table?
He brings great energy, great ideas. When I first asked him to do it, he'd been coming to my other cabaret show. And a couple of times he said, you're really an actor. And I said, yes. And he said, well, it really comes through. And I love that because I'm a singer. Yes. But I've always, as same as you, I love being an actor more than I love being a singer. So he caught that. I loved that he was really generous with good feedback. So I asked him to direct the show and he said yes. So he brings a lot of energy, a lot of great ideas from an actor standpoint. So I'm re-listening to our final rehearsal we did before we did it the very first time. And I'm listening to his notes to me. And it's really actor's notes that he's giving me, which I love. He also came up with, I brought songs to Ted and Ted's like, I don't think that's going to work. It's another ballad. And we're like, can we make it a beat? Can we change the rhythm? And it was Lance's idea that took the very next man and made it a really sultry kind of ballad, which is one of my favorite songs in the show. So that was Lance's idea. Lance had the same idea with a couple other songs. I'm trying to think what, but he brought a lot of good theater ideas, acting ideas. He brought some great musical ideas and he brought some of his friends to the show, which is great because it introduces Sheldon's music to all new people, which we love as well. And he's got a great reputation as an actor on Broadway, actor, yeah. Singer. He's always on Broadway and he's always had a great reputation as a director, but he's becoming more and more upfront as a director now too and performer. I think he goes to the Goodman in right after my show in Chicago to do a play. So he's always working and I love that too because he brings that energy and, uh-huh. and joy to be there. And he's been telling me since 1995, I need to live in New York. We started working together in 91 or 92. And when I would be in New York, we'd meet up and we'd walk around. He'd tell me the songs at Colony he thought I should buy. He told me the songs I need to be playing. He showed me the Equity office and he said, you need to be here. So why didn't I listen to him? I mean, it's not that I didn't, but life gets in the way, but isn't that neat? So we go back
when it's meant to happen. I really do believe that.
I do believe that too.
You touched upon this a little bit, but I want to go to Ted Firth. You also have an incredible working relationship with Ted and he does great arrangements, but let's face it. He is one of the busiest working musical directors, arrangers in the business. And I know how difficult and frustrating that can be, not only for yourself, but for everybody. You want the best and you've got the best. But what is it about Ted and what he brings to the table and why him for this particular project?
Well, I'll tell you how we met. He used to be, well, he still is, musical director for Tom Wopat and some of my friends. And I went to see him play for Tom a couple of times. And I think I heard them, I can't remember where this first time, maybe Boston. No, it was somewhere else. He moved me to tears. He put so much feeling in his playing. So when I went to see them in Boston, because I was working in Boston, they were at Harvard. I took my demo to him and I said, I want to work with you someday. And he's like, okay. But I didn't think I'd ever be able to afford him really. So fast forward a couple of years, I write him and I say, I'm thinking about doing my a show again in New York. Are you available? And he wrote back, I'd love to work with you. Let's set some dates. And as busy he was back then, he wasn't as busy as he is now. And he was book solid, but he could throw out dates. They'd easily fill up, but now it's even harder to get them. So what he brings is brilliant ideas, great musicianship, like unmatchable musicianship, professionalism. He also always comes in you know, a performer has enough nervous energy on their own and enough, you know, details to deal with on their own. And Ted comes in calm as a cucumber, despite what he's dealing with the minute he left something else and comes into your play. And brilliant arrangements. I mean, everybody talks about my CD and his contribution to the way, not only the way he comes up with creative arrangements, but also the way he plays. So it's a thrill to have him on this this project. But he was my idea from the very beginning. He did my CD and my first show that we did, the revision of An Evening with Jennifer Roberts. And I immediately asked him if he wanted to do this, and he said yes. And so we just started meeting together every time I was in New York, two or three times. We started working on a third show shortly before COVID. And then he said, well, we met once, I guess. And he said, well, send me the ideas of what you want for the songs and I can do this on my own time. And then send me some. So I sent him some ideas through COVID and we're talking about starting up again. And then he just got too busy. So we were going to resume, I think, in late 2021. And he goes, I got to put it on hold because now I'm doing this arranging thing, which, you know, he seems to take. But he did all these things in a row. And you'll notice that a lot of his regulars, he doesn't play with every time anymore because he's even that much more busy. So, yeah, I just love to work with him and he makes it fun and always brilliant. And I love the fact that we both love to do things, you know, spontaneously. Go ahead.
On the rare occasion that I've had to work with him, he's simply one of the best. Well, Jennifer, this hour flew. I can't believe that the hour is gone. Don't go anywhere for a moment because I'm going to give you a chance to have your final word. I want to bring this up for a moment again. And I want to remind everyone that on April 30th at 7 o'clock, Green Room 42, reservations are very, very important, everyone. I know a lot of people wait to the last minute to do things, but in this case, please reserve. It lets everyone know how they're doing. It lets the venue know. They staff based on the reservations, so it's important to do that. I also want to let everyone know who's watching today that you can help elevate this particular broadcast by leaving a comment on YouTube, hitting the like button, and sharing. And also, if you're not a subscriber, I hope that you will subscribe and check out the over 900 interviews that are already there. I love you so much, and it's such a thrill to have you here. I'm going to give my closing remarks, and then I'm going to give you a chance to have your closing remarks, and then we're going to end with another clip of you. It could be about anything that we spoke about today that you want to build upon, anything that we didn't talk about that you wish we had, or just any final message you want to leave everyone with today. And then when you say goodbye, the last clip will roll, so you don't have to worry about anything. Everyone, I end every show with the same message. And it's not just lip service. I live by this. Jennifer will tell you I live by this. Go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. When today's show is over, I would like all of you, including you, Jennifer, to go to your Facebook friends list. And the fourth name that pops up, reach out to that person with a phone call. Not an email message, not a text message, not a private inbox message, a phone call. And let that person know the impact that they've made on your life. And by doing so, you're going to make an impact on their life. I have a dear friend, Sean Moniger, and he says, we're all in the same storm, but we're in different size boats. And I always say, I don't care what size boat you're on, as long as you have a skipper by your side. And with that, I'm going to leave the screen. And Jennifer, it's all yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. I will say to you, I love you too with all my heart. You've been a very true, loyal friend, and you never have strings attached. So I'm most grateful. I say, follow your dream, folks. Do what you love to do. I had this Sheldon Harnick idea because his work moved me to take it to my musical director and plant the seed. We should do a show while he's still living. And as a result of that, he came to my show himself. I get to put this brilliant work out there that a lot of people have not experienced or heard. That's one of my passions. I love history. I love to find old gems that people don't really know about because everybody celebrates his greatest hits. So I hope that people, it's live stream too, but I hope people support it. And get the word out that Sheldon was far more than just his greatest hits. He's brilliant, and I want to pay it forward because he added and gave us so much in the musical theater realm, the novelty song realm, and the beautiful ballad realm. God bless you all. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on April 30th.
Will he like me? I don't know. All I know is that I'm tempted not to go. It's insanity for me to worry so. I'll try not to. Will he like me? He's just got to. Will he like me?